Thank you. I'm glad that I'm the last one, because I think what I have to say matters. And maybe I would be able, you know, to entertain you also with changing your view of what you consider startups today. I know that most of you are not engineers. And by engineers, I mean the more physical sense of engineering. And that's fine. But as an entrepreneur, I must also tell you that you have to hack things. And you have to play around. And the biggest thing that we have to hack is this place where we live in and we call home. So, do you have any astronauts in the room? I know my colleague before asked if there is any people who have WordPress. So I up him up and I said, any astronauts? Anybody who belongs to a space society? I think not. Well, let me tell you, every single one of you is an astronaut. You are living on a freaking rock that's hurling through space at 250,000 miles per hour. You are traveling on this little planet. You know that thing behind me? This is a celestial object. You qualify to call yourself an astronaut. So if you have an About Me page, just go ahead and put astronaut first and foremost. How is that? How cool is that? I mean, how many kids are going to grow up today to say, I'm going to be an astronaut? They already are. I am an astronaut, you are an astronaut, she is an astronaut. Every single one of you. And yet, you know, this spaceship we are dealing with, nobody is minding the controls. Nobody is willing to stand up and take responsibility and say, I will be steering the ship. Nobody wants to be pilot and commander. Nobody is willing to take true ownership of this celestial object, this spaceship that we are all traveling on. And I'm challenging you, and I know you all care, you know, to make some money and go to Silicon Valley and build the next, you know, bullshit mobile application or the next, you know, Facebook look-alike or all this other stuff. I'm going to tell you, it's been done 3,000 times, all different ways and backwards. It's not worth it. You know, open up your view. Think big, or at least think bigger. And look at the spaceship and say, you know, there's a lot of jobs that can be done. There's a lot of startups. There's a lot of opportunity. There is a lot of entrepreneurship that we can invest ourselves in truly and passionately and solve problems that we are all facing and things that we are sharing. And about the engineering bit, you don't even have to be an engineer. There's a lot of social, there's a lot of mobile, there's a lot of other interesting things that can dovetail with good science, honest science, earth science, chemical science, all kinds of physics that you can actually involve into creating solutions for the little blue planet we are all traveling on. So, why do I say this? Well, I care. I care because, you know, we have a small organization which tries to manage the affairs of this planet, and I happen to be one of the founders of it. And we try to manage the affairs not because we claim any kind of leadership or because, you know, we are crazy Dr. Strangelove lookalikes, but simply because we have allowed ourselves to go too far and too long into a form of acceptance that the air can suck, that the water can smell, and that the food that you eat, you know, is not good for you. And that got to change. So I'm already thinking that you have ideas of how you can reshape this environment that we all share. And the best way to reshape the environment is to take ownership and say, I live on this planet, you know, I'm traveling through space on it, and, you know, I'm going to do something that's going to serve me. And if it does serve you well, it will also serve all the others who live here. And you will not just be famous and wealthy, but you will also have some meaning in your life. And that bit about meaning, it makes it really interesting, you know, to be here. Because without a meaningful life, all manner of success, no matter how beautiful, how famous, how successful and wealthy you become, it really does not resonate with the effect that you have on others. In this society, we've been built as wanting to be of service to others, and that's the highest accolade. This is the highest meaningful support you can get, you know, because even when you were little, all of you, you asked, what is my purpose here? And maybe some people told you, you know, there's some kind of religion, you know, there's heaven and hell and all this other interesting stuff, and that's cool if you want to believe. But if you really have to get meaning out of life, you must also engage and understand that meaning does not come cheap. Meaning it's not for free. It's the most expensive thing you're going to find, and you have to invest in it. And what do you invest? You invest in being of value. You invest in being of service. You invest in being somebody whom the other people look up for leadership. Every single one of you can be a leader because you do need your help. I agree. I mean, at your time, I wasn't even so keen as you are, you know, to start new things. So I believe that you can do a lot better than me. You look smarter, you look fitter, you look sexier. At the end, you speak French very well, you know. It's very romantic. Startup thinks that you have the best science locally. France and Paris is known for having some of the best geoengineers on Earth. People here who understand everything from geology to astronomy and back very, very well. And yet, you don't know them. They might be going to the same school in different departments and you have no connection. And that's the failing. The failing is building the bridge. As an entrepreneur, first and foremost, you got to build a bridge to the scientists in your own universities and your own cities. Because the chemists and the physicists, they will help you do proper startups that solve big problems. So my suggestion to you, and I know this is a long day for most of you, but take something home that can help you, is go out and meet via Facebook or via LinkedIn or just walk into the classes that they teach elementary and basic physics. And go and meet scientists that you can partner with and actually create meaningful startups that solve big problems. It's chemistry that allows us to live here, and it's a very fine type of chemistry that creates a balance in our atmosphere, and we call this phenomenon Goldilocks, because it has to be so just right to just allow us to have an air that we can breathe. To have an air that is not angry with us and that doesn't cause asthma to the children. Why? Why do I say this? One out of every three children who are born today in Paris is born with asthma. Now, does anybody have any medical doctors, friends? I'm sure you do. Talk to them about it. And you're going to find that the quality of the air in the city is not so great, and perhaps the chemistry in the food and the chemistry that we have in the water is associated directly with that. There's all other things, you know, that have to do, you know, with the allergies people have, you know, and failures of the immune systems. All of those things are solvable. Everything that you see on the news, you know, as being a threat to humanity is a solvable, easily solvable, as a matter of fact, problem. So if you tend to focus on the small things, and everybody tries to say that I'm going to do a small mobile application because, well, I can manage that. I can get a couple of mobile engineers, you know, get some marketing guys, find some venture capital, and that's that. But what I'm telling you is kind of go deeper and find true scientists who understand big problems and you can solve it with them and do the startups of the future. Because today, and this is a very healthy statistic, only about 7 to 9%, depending how you count it, of venture capital available around the earth is geared towards green things. It's geared towards, you know, green technology, green energy, clean technology, clean energy, and biotech, useful biotech, biotech for our food as well, and biotech for our water. Those are very useful things, but they don't make neither the news, nor do they make the bridge to the entrepreneurial societies and to the entrepreneurship schools and the technology schools that are very necessary in order to allow for these concepts to come to the market. The engineers, and especially the heavy scientists, they're a very insular lot. They don't like to talk too much. They like to spend time alone in the laboratory. And that doesn't make for very good social interconnection with you lot. So if you step out of your own regular environment and you decide to meet them and kind of coax out of them, you know, the best possibilities for startups that solve big problems, I will tell you, you'll have a success. So that 7 to 9% of venture capital today that is geared towards environmental issues is scheduled to grow to about 15% next year because we are facing some serious problems. I have come from Doha now, and Doha, if anybody knows, is the place where we had the climate negotiations in Qatar. You know, that little place in the desert that produces a lot of oil and gas. And the United Nations decided this year to hold the climate negotiations there. It's a complete wasteland, and the climate negotiations, they were a complete failure. And it's a consistent failure for 20 years. We've been negotiating about trying to solve the climate problems with universal policy and with common agreements for 20 years, and we are failing. So we decided at the Environmental Parliament, enough is enough. We will take a cue, you know, from our founders and say that we will crowdsource the solutions, and we will invite every single one of you and anybody else that we talk to, people that we know, to help us find visible marketplace solutions that involve business, industry, commerce, enterprise, and academia, pure science, in order to solve the big climate problems that we are facing, in order to prevent climate change from creating climate chaos, in order to allow you to live in a planet that you can call home comfortably. The slides behind me, I'm sure you've all had some inkling of what is going on. And I don't want to say that things are improving. They are not. They're actually becoming far worse than what they've ever been. Just today, there was a report released from the Environmental Parliament which states that the speed of the ice melting throughout the Arctic zones is so far greater than what we knew already that is threatening a tipping point in our climate, because not only does it release CO2, you know, that carbon dioxide that creates the greenhouse effect, but it also releases methane. And methane is a far worse chemical in our atmosphere than carbon dioxide, because it's about hundreds of times, 325 times more warming as an agent in the atmosphere than carbon. So take that as a heed and understand that when we release these vast amounts into our atmosphere, the planet starts warming at an accelerated rate. It is not entirely out of the question that due to our lack of action, we can turn Earth into a Venus. And I don't think that any of us can survive on Venus. It's just too damn hot. So we had some ideas that some of these things that you see, they can be translated into simple science concepts that you can make enterprises around it. The biggest opportunity that exists for creating new billionaires, people who can make more money than Bill Gates ever had, they are the ones who will stem out of solving the big crisis that humanity faces, global warming. And they all have to be small. I know that someone, hopefully from France, will come up with a nifty way of cleaning the atmosphere from carbon and depositing the carbon, you know, underground or some other way, making it useful. There has to be. There are solutions. It's simple, basic science. We can do it. There are already startups, in America mainly, that they look at that problem and they have invested quite a lot of money. But we haven't got a practical, market-driven solution. It is just too expensive to do. So this innovation will come from the university science departments and from entrepreneurs like you. But you have to look at it. Today, the way that I understand it, none of you is looking at it. Everybody else is looking, you know, into the little world of mobiles, you know, and internet, which is fine. But remember, your home is this. When I talk about species, I want to make a parallel between certain species who know how to move and others that don't. Human beings, they tend to be very sedentary today. They used to be very nomadic in the past. As you know, today we all have national borders. The moment you have to move, you have to use a passport. Well, okay, good. In the past, that wasn't the case. With species, you only think of the beautiful things like animals and mammals. But I'm going to talk about plants, because the plants, they also need to migrate due to climate change. We already have, as of this year, 2012, about 60 million, get this, 60 million climate refugees as human beings. Well, nobody is tracking, though, the plants and the animal life that needs to migrate in order to survive. And I'm sure you know this old English guy called Charles Darwin. Right? You remember the species studies he did, the taxonomy of the species? Well, when Darwin, you know, spoke about the species adaptation, he was not describing by fittest any of the traits that we associate with human beings. Plants cannot move as fast as global warming is warming our atmosphere. They just simply go extinct. We already experienced that with certain kinds of plant, with the big ash trees, you know, in England. We experience it in the northeast United States with the very big trees. And other trees, they come to take their place, that they do better in a climate that is richer with CO2 and warmer. The pine, the soft pine of Georgia, is moving up to New York State. That's a huge distance. And that represents the way that the climate is warming, the species that are not adaptable, they are not able to withstand, nor are they able to travel fast in order to survive. If one thing Darwin told us about our capacity to innovate, it was that we create the traits that make it possible for us, human beings, not to find a better home, but it is easier for us to move home, up stakes and move to another area. This is what we did in our long history when we started out from those lush valleys of Congo. We all got started, you know, as African people, in a valley in Congo, and we migrated throughout the earth. The reason we did that, it was not just because it was uncomfortable to live where we are, but as climate changes and it allowed new areas for us to populate, we just took it. The reverse thing is happening now, into which there are going to be vast areas of this earth that they will simply be unpopular with human beings because it's just too difficult to live there. The 60 million refugees that I mentioned earlier, they came from a beautiful area that was the breadbasket of Africa, and it's called the Horn of Africa, otherwise known as the Horn of Plenty. The Horn of Plenty now, there's nothing plentiful there. There's no water, therefore you have no agriculture. When you have a drought, you cannot eat. It's as simple as that. And in other areas of Africa, we see that, but we also see it in Indonesia, we see it in China, we see it in Eastern Asia, we see it in Latin America. These things happen because the belt around the equator, it receives a lot more heat and increases in temperature than any other place on Earth. But the same thing happens on the poles. So the Arctic is the object of the study that was released today by the Environmental Parliament, and the Arctic is the one that is warming the fastest than any place on Earth. Therefore, the permafrost, this ancient ice that's been there for about 13 million years, is melting so fast that it exposes the methane and the CO2 that's trapped beneath. And that gets released in the atmosphere, magnifying the warming effect, magnifying the greenhouse effect. These are some ideas of things that every single one of these words there represents a business opportunity. If we cannot solve the big picture, if we cannot solve the capacity of humanity as a whole to reduce our CO2 emissions in the atmosphere and the greenhouse effect, we have to take local solutions, utilize business, commerce, and everything you've got, startups and entrepreneurship, in order to solve the individual components of this problem. And this is virgin territory. This is a greenscape for you. It's a greenfield opportunity. Every single one of these areas can be tackled, and there is enough capital to finance you and to venture whatever you wish forward. You don't need to compete with 300 other people who are doing a Facebook look-alike. You don't have to compete with 300 other companies who are trying to imitate Twitter or whatever else there is, you know, in your mobile applications. Just think. There's a new sphere. Just look around you. It is called nature. And you can involve yourselves with it because it actually needs your help in terms of finding solutions. We represent pretty much the biggest organism, but our adaptation is not assured. This is what I suggest is the solutions that we have. We've got to act on it. You know, I'm sure you've all experienced personally and firsthand the effects of climate change. But have you thought that you can actually build business around the solutions? So I came here today just to speak on that and to nudge you forward very gently, but also economically, that you must act and develop business ideas and new enterprises to solve the problems that we are facing, the big problems, the problems that humanity faces. And that thing that I told you earlier, remember, about meaning? This is the most meaningful thing you can be doing with your life today and for the next foreseeable centuries. This is not a problem that's going away, nor is it a problem that's going to be solved. This is something we have to live with. Human beings know how to innovate. I believe all of you are healthy, young, fit innovators. However, your capacity to survive without innovating at this moment, it is being diminished. When you say the poor will suffer the most, well, I believe that we don't have any of us, you know, here that can qualify under this. However, I must tell you that our societies, they go into something called climate debt. And the planetary debt makes us all poor. And there is no poverty worse than not being able to breathe the air that surrounds you, not being able to drink the water into which, you know, you find yourself, and not being able to eat the food that is available. And that thing is happening. That dystopia is happening today throughout the world. It is not news. Most of us, we suffer from diseases that are related to the poor quality of air, poor quality of water, and the poor quality of food that we consume. Ponder that. Just think about it. And you tell me how many business solutions that can exist that you can actually solve just thinking along these three things. Air, water, food. And all of those, they are financeable, all of those can be ventured, and all of those solutions, they will make you, you know, wealthy, famous, and respected. And most importantly, they will give you meaning, you know, in this life. We've had the Millennium Development Goals with the United Nations. We've been running them for about 15 years. Do you know where we are with them? We have failed on all the Millennium Development Goals. We have failed miserably. And we are failing on the environment as well. We have a challenge. We can meet it together. We are willing to support young entrepreneurs who are going to take the challenge and create companies, concepts that are science-based to find solutions in all the problems we discussed. We do have a hope that most of you will find this challenge as not another thing that would steal your heart, you know, for the next couple of hours and will be forgotten tomorrow while you are still looking at the next mobile thing. I challenge you that this is where the real wealth exists. Venture capital is increasingly focused on this area. Private equity is increasingly focused on this area. I know I am. But most importantly, this is something that it will be your legacy. And this is something into which you can shine well beyond, you know, the bounds of your own private business. With that, if you want to communicate further, I want to thank you very much.
So basically, when you're a young student, you still go to see engineer, physical engineer, when it's not at all your area of expertise, it might be seems that a hard leap, difficult leap. What would be like advice to, like, to go like smoothly in, maybe in this direction? What would you advise students to do?
Yes, thank you. Thank you. My advice to this is that it is a lot easier, cheaper, and more efficient to launch a company that solves problems as the ones I described, either in clean tech, green tech, and green technology, than doing any other kind of startup. Simply because those scientists that I already mentioned, they all have research grants, and every single thing that we do can qualify for specific research grants from the European Union, which is a money that you never have to repay. And while utilizing this capital, you can be building your company without having a venture capitalist looking over your shoulder. So this is another thing, and thank you, you brought it up, that is very available, especially from the European Union products. The European Union has earmarked 5 billion euros finding the big solutions, because it's the only federation on this earth that actually has a green policy. The European Union has a policy named 20-20-20. I was the author of that policy early on, before it was owned by the European Union, and we pushed it. And now it became the law in all 27 countries. And what that law says, by the year 2020, by the end, December of the year 2020, the European Union must be producing 20% of its energy out of renewable resources, clean resources, basically air, you know, the wind, from the sea, the tidal and wave energy, geothermal, perhaps. Solar is the most popular, as you know. These are the clean resources that the Union is sponsoring. And this policy provides ample opportunity for any kind of business you can come up with. And you will be given grants, which is basically money that you do not need to repay if you follow those research projects and you create enterprises that address this issue. And the sweetest thing you can tell to a venture capital firm when you go and meet to them is, by the way, I've been funded by the European Union with a research grant, you know, of such and such. You know, it's an easy street. You can start your company a lot easier. And you will be solving a big problem.
Thank you. Question.
Hello. Sorry for my English. It will not be great like Pedro, but I'm asking me, a kickoff for green startups will be not the fact that e-commerce is dead, and it will be more rentable to do green business and not niche market. You understand me, or I can repeat if you want?
If I understand the question well, is if it's easier to reach the niche markets for green businesses as opposed to the larger markets.
Yeah.
Yes, it is always easier to find aspects of the solution market-orientated that are within your niche. And you will find it once you partner up and you cross the bridge with the scientists. Because guess what? All scientists, especially earth scientists, they're very, very focused on an area that's exclusively their own domain. So the niche is already there. You just have to exploit the niche and build a business around it. And they will welcome that because, as we said before, scientists are terrible entrepreneurs. They really don't know and they don't even want to communicate because they're too focused on the research aspect of it. So they need one of you, every single one of you, in order to find those niche opportunities and take them to market with fabulous results, building great businesses. These are going to be the great businesses of the next century. The next century is not going to be made up, you know, with the Googles and the Microsofts of the past and the Apple. Don't look to the past to find inspiration for the future. Yesterday is gone, completely finished. Steve Jobs is dead. Okay? You look at the new people of the future. There is great opportunity. Don't imitate the past if you're going to create your own future. Other questions?
Yeah. Question?
Hi. How would you advise a business to communicate about all this green development regarding all the greenwashing all the consumers got before? How to keep this confidence between the company and the consumers?
This is a great question. How do you address the issue of greenwashing? I am very happy to tell you that one of the reasons that I'm here this week is because I speak with a group of two people from ESCP in Paris that they just started a company to address this issue. How to rate companies and prevent them from greenwashing. Governments, including sometimes, you know, the European government, they do a lot of greenwashing. And I don't need to talk about companies, you know. British Petroleum advertises itself as, you know, the sun. They're using this beautiful sun, you know, to peddle dirty oil. So, yes, there is a lot of greenwashing. It's a fantastic opportunity. I just spoke of a company that's been built today here. There is a lot more companies that can be built to prevent greenwashing and to actually address the issue of honesty. Some of it would be on the scale of advertisement. Some of this would be, you know, on the PR landscape. Some of these companies that you build would be simply like the rating agencies. Some of them would be, you know, the intensity of capital per company. financial innovation is a fantastic area into which a lot of you can get involved, because it takes financial innovation also to address climate change. It takes all the skills, everything that we have as society, to throw at it in order to do this little thing that Charles Darwin, you know, asked us to do. Adapt or perish. Because the fittest, the one who survives, is not the most pervasive, the one who has most members, is not the strongest species, is not the most beautiful, or the one that has, you know, the best DNA. The fittest, and the one who survives according to Charles Darwin and to our biological reality, is the species and the people that are able to change. That's it. Fitness means change in that world of biology. And I ask you to change your focus, which is not that difficult, and to look at this great landscape, which is virgin and full of opportunity, in order to create your next companies.
So, hi. Well, the permafrost is melting, and there is in the permafrost twice the amount of CO2 there is in the atmosphere. So it might mean that by the year 2050 we'll be well above the 4 degrees tipping point, we'll be well above that. Which means that, well, anyway, there will be something, a loss like of half the biodiversity, that the oceans will rise of more than 1 meter. And, I mean, this is very real. I mean, this is almost certain now, this is almost a certainty. So the world we will be living in the year 2050 will be very different from the world we are living now. And yes, we need all the start-upers, all these, like, creative class of entrepreneurs to find the solutions of problems we actually ignore, actually we are still ignoring. We just know that we will have a soup of problems by 2050, but we don't know really what's gonna, well, we don't really know the shape, the exact shape of these problems. So I have a question for you. Do you think we actually have a shot at making it and solving all these issues? And if yes, well, this is really our role as startupers. And so it kind of makes us the new, well, superheroes of this world, in a way. So we should be much more aggressive in promoting entrepreneurs and startupers than we are currently.
Right on. Right on. I couldn't have said it better. I mean, that is the reality we are all facing. Maybe I will change the dates a little bit. Instead of 2050, I will say 2030. Today, I just received a report from the Environmental Parliament, and I put on my blog some of the key sentences of it. Please look at it. It's called the Bleeding Edge blog. No, not leading edge, bleeding, because if you touch your finger on the leading edge, it cuts you. So Bleeding Edge blog, Pano Croco, again, at WordPress. Check it out, today's article. It will tell you specifically that the melting of the permafrost is accelerating at a rate that will give us a tipping point in the climate by 2030, not 2050. Look it up today. And what does that mean? That perhaps, you know, you have to innovate in finding, you know, solar parasols to protect us, you know, from the solar radiation. There is a lot of opportunity to create fantastic things to survive. But answering the second part of his question, what are my feelings, are we going to make it or not, that I cannot answer. Because if I tell you today that I'm going to smile and we are surely going to make it and there is no worries, you're not going to do anything. You're just going to do your next mobile, or you're going to go in the duvet, you know, and cover up and say, I don't care, or have a party. All good things. I support them. But if I tell you that we are not going to make it, you're going to lose hope. And you're going to be depressed, and you're not going to do anything also. So I can't tell you you're going to make it or not, because I can't read the future. But I can certainly read the science and tell you that unless we act together and create the necessary solutions to solve the problems via innovative enterprises, we certainly are not going to make it. So yes, we'll make it if we act together and we start swimming. In community, in unison, working with the scientists, speaking to the scientists who know what's necessary to happen and creating enterprises around these solutions. And then we'll make it. But hope comes from action. So thank you for this question. It's fantastic.
So thank you. I think we're good at time. And thank you, Bernard.
Thank you very much.